We can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pulifito. The call-in number is 212-245-7273, 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to listen to the phone and not the show, because we're on an 8-second delay, which means while you're watching the show, I'll be hanging up and you have to call back. Also, lower the volume on your computer or your TV, because we don't want any feedback. And plus, if you like, you can give us your first name and location where you're calling from. Again, it's 212-245-7273. And as you see, we have a guest tonight, Diane Tinsley. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Diane is Vice President of Community Education Council.
Yes.
District 5.
Yes.
Which is located in Harlem.
In Harlem.
Okay. Before we get started, I'm not sure how many people are familiar with what a community education council is and how does that fit in with the school boards and whatever else. So if you just give us a little explanation.
Well, the easiest way to explain what we are and what we do is that we are basically the school boards in New York City. So what we do is we support the schools, we support the parents, we support the students, and we're elected by the parents of the city to these positions. Or you can be appointed by the borough president. I happen to be a brewer this year for this term.
How much did you have to pay her?
No.
just teasing, because you know what, that's the first word out of a lot of people's mouths these days.
No money changed hands.
Okay, so basically, Gail appointed you to say, why don't you come on the council for community, for District 5?
Yes, well, I was on the council. I was elected by parents to my prior term, which was a 2-year term. And Gail saw the work that we were doing as a council and how we were trying to move the district in a positive way. So I put in my paperwork, and she basically said, well, you know, there's no way you're getting out of this. So
that's right. You're working hard.
Exactly. So you're going to keep on working.
So besides being on the council,
yes.
Are you a teacher or a principal somewhere, or you're just a normal, average office worker or whatever? Because how did you get from point A to point B to be on this council?
I'm a parent.
That's a good qualification.
That was it. That was pretty much my launch pad into this, and I worked up through the ranks. I was on the PTA as a treasurer, and then after that I progressed to the student leadership team, which is part of each school. You have this team of parents and teachers and the principal who sort of make decisions for the school community. I was on that, which launched me to the Community Education Council with District 5.
And now you're here.
And now I'm
now
here.
You're good at that.
Yes.
So while you were there, I guess you noticed there were some discrepancies in what was going on in the schools, whether it was elementary or middle school, or there were some concerns that you submitted Freedom of Information Act to see to get some information about concerning librarians and so on?
Yes. When I came on the council in my first term, I was actually shocked by the things in the school system that were not happening and not working. I grew up in District 5. I was educated in District 5. And to find out at one of our council meetings that the New York City Department of Education is violating state law regarding middle and high school students, and that the fact that they are mandated librarians and a library space in each middle and high school. And this was being violated. And I was shocked, because I remember going to school in District 5 and having a librarian and a library space. So I couldn't believe that. The Harlem Council of Elders actually brought this issue to our attention as the council.
Okay. And before we proceed, who are they and what do they do?
The Harlem Council of Elders is a powerful group of seniors in the Harlem community, all professionals, all retired, who compiled data, who wrote original letters to the chancellor, to the mayor regarding this violation and this issue, and had been working and still are working on it.
When you mean mayor, you mean de Blasio.
De Blasio.
Okay, so it doesn't go further back then.
Yes.
I just want to make sure, because you know the way city goes and things
it's
are.
True.
This could have started way back with Koch for like.
It's
amazing at Bloomberg.
It's whatever, true. Yeah. It's true.
Okay, so they were working with it. So how did would they contact you to say?
They came to one of our meetings and they did a presentation about it, and my jaw hit the floor. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And I, right then and there, decided to be a liaison between the Community Education Council and the Harlem Council of Elders.
Okay.
So I would attend their meetings and support their rallies and their petition signings and any way I could help and support. I was right there. And I so appreciate them for compiling the data and bringing this to our attention.
Okay, so, well, since they brought this data, what you wanted to confirm it with the city, with the DOE, the Department of Education, you presented these FOIL requests?
Yes, and one of the meetings with the Harlem Council of Elders, the conversation came up that maybe as a Community Education Council member, I could get some answers that they haven't been able to get.
Oh, I got you. So they didn't get the full picture.
Exactly. So I submitted a FOIL.
Okay. Which was back in 2016, was it?
Yes.
Okay.
I submitted a FOIL on their behalf and our behalf as a council. But who knew it would take almost 2 years for me to get an answer?
That's right. Because like I was just showing when you were talking, is that, you know, you in the Post and also Fox 5 News concerning this, and here was one of the articles that they did on you, the Post, is that the deal with Department of Education stalls.
Yes.
And I bet you would think that's a simple request.
Yes.
And they said basically it was unreasonable, what you were asking, to find out how many librarians or certified media specialists is what it's called.
Right, and that was the question. How many librarians or certified media specialists do we have in District 5?
Right.
That was the question.
And from what we heard from the Council of Elders is that, I heard a figure like only 25% of the schools had it, the middle schools or something like that?
Yeah, a very low level.
Yeah, because I think also in the article mentioned something as well.
Yes.
So we went out to confirm, is this true or not?
And our thought as a council was that if we contact the DOE with this question, they keep the data. They're the keepers of the information. So this is a no-brainer. We would get that back in no time. But almost 2 years later, I got an answer.
And basically, it's just mandated more.
It is state law.
It's state law, but not for elementary schools.
Not for elementary schools, but a lot of our elementary schools do have libraries and librarians.
Okay.
But it's mandated for the middle and high schoolers to prepare them for their college years.
Okay.
And to give them the fundamental research skills that they need.
So basically, the librarian is not so much to say, well, here's this book and that book, but also have to help them with their skills to do research.
Exactly.
So they know where to look.
Exactly.
And besides that, to go out in other sources like Google or whatever, but come back. But you need someone to be your coach, to be a mentor, to say, you know, I have a report on whatever, volcanoes.
Exactly.
How can you help me to put a report together for volcanoes and things like that? And that's what's lacking.
Exactly.
So then when they go into, I think you said, go into college, and then they're not really on level playing field.
No.
At that time.
No.
Okay.
No, they're not. And then now that since we're in an age of technology, that's why they've changed the title to media specialist instead of librarians. They say the title of librarians is antiquated.
Oh,
and
okay.
Teachers aren't going to school to become librarians anymore, but they will become media specialists.
Okay.
Which is fine, because in the age of technology, that's fine. The children need to know how to navigate through the computers and, like you said, Google and different you know, search engines to find not fake news but accurate sources of information that they can use.
And that's what's lacking there.
That's what's lacking.
Is it just in district? I the community education, CEC District 5, mm-hmm. is directly related to School District 5, or is that how it is?
Yes.
In four is
exactly.
So how about, but there's more school districts in Harlem than just District 5, where am I?
We have us in District 5, and then we have District 3 has some Harlem schools.
Okay.
And then District 6 has a few okay. Harlem schools.
So during your research, did you branch out to the other district to see exactly what has been going on? Did the FOIL request just say District 5, or did it say District 6 and District...
No.
Just to get a picture.
Exactly. No, my FOIL request was just for District 5.
Okay. And I get the feeling is that, the budget this year, I think I saw the Blasio was at $25 billion for education this year.
Mm-hmm.
$25
billion. Mm-hmm.
And my focus is, do you think that, is this happening in other schools outside of Harlem?
Yes, but I don't believe it's happening to the same degree.
As prevalent as in, with
in
Harlem.
District 5, yes.
Okay, because I'm just... Well, maybe I'll come back because mm-hmm. I heard also that there's the most charter schools are in Harlem.
Yes,
that's
true.
That's a different story. All right, we could go on, but basically we're talking about your FOIL request and say, hey, look, what's going on with the media specialist here?
Yes.
All right, and finally, after a year and a half, 2 years,
almost two years,
yeah. You got a response, but I see here that there's another letter that went out to. The chancellor requesting more information?
Yes, because I'm also the chair of a subcommittee in our CEC, which is the... And then through the legal of attorneys such as Pierre Gooding and others, this letter to the chancellor was drafted based on us just asking in August... You did a press conference saying that a reading initiative was going to
okay,
be...
Okay, hold on.
I'm so sorry.
No. Don't say that because, you know, that's a good segue
okay.
into the news. Is this the one that I'm going to... That's just the little piece of it. If I could find it now, what happened?
Yes, that's the rebuttal to my interview with Fox 5 that the... Chancellor,
anyhow, she answered the question without answering the question.
Absolutely.
Oh,
to the top, to school's chancellor. Sometimes things go by the wayside, and they shouldn't have been. So this is one that we're working on right now. But it was also our head of libraries had left for another job. There was a vacancy in that particular title. It's now filled, so we expect to fulfill the FOIL request. As we speak.
As for whether the department is experiencing a shortage of librarians,
I think with librarians in terms of vacancies are really a school-based decision. I mean, there is a regulation. We don't have a requirement to have librarians in elementary school. In middle schools, it often depends on the school budget. If you have a school of 200, you may not have it, but if you have a school of 1,300, chances are you're going to have a librarian.
We followed up with the Department of Education on this tonight, and a spokesperson said while there are challenges in identifying and hiring library media specialists in New York City and across the state, we'll continue our investments in libraries and students' reading skills. Meanwhile, the department tells us they're also investing in a universal literacy initiative, which will be coming to Harlem districts soon. Christina? All right. Stacey Delcat, thank you.
Okay. And before we proceed a little bit further, I do have a phone call. So
okay.
Let's see you at the caller. Hello, you're on Decent Life. Hello? Hello? Okay, you're going to need to call back, please. Okay, so let's continue. So basically she says that what was interesting is she goes, there's no law for elementary schools, but you're not talking about elementary schools.
You're talking about
middle schools.
Exactly.
So she didn't answer the question about what the librarians are going to do. How are they going to achieve the librarians?
No. Nor did she say that the DOE was going to give funds to the schools to support their efforts in reestablishing their libraries.
Okay, because that was a good point. She said that it was a school-based decision now. She's
yes.
basically delegating to the schools
yes.
what they need to do, where this is an actual law.
Yeah. But if you look at the bigger picture with schools, and which brings in the issue of charter schools.
Okay, hold that thought. I think the call is calling back. Hello, you're on Decent Life. Hello, you're John. I'm afraid we have a bad connection here because I can't. I'm sorry. I can't hear you. Hello, can you hear him? I'm sorry, sir. All right, you know, sometimes we get bad connections.
Yeah.
So anyway, we're back with Farina and the budget for individual schools.
All right. Schools do get their individual budgets, but if you look at all the lines of where money is spent and where the Community Education Council, what we have identified is the fact that charter schools, not all, but many charter schools will accept children because they're based on a lottery. But towards the end of October, or maybe even November, December, the children are suspended or asked to move on or not in that charter school anymore, but the charter school keeps the money. And then the family falls back onto their zone school, which is a public school or a different public school. But the money...
Excuse me. So, you know, everybody's got a little cough nowadays.
Yes.
Okay, so the money...
So the money stays with the charter school. So why, yes, each public school gets a budget. If the public school at some point during their academic year gets an influx of charter school students who are not in school anymore... They don't get that money. Yes, we have a budget, but now we have to provide services and resources to the children who are no longer in charter schools whose money did not travel with them.
Okay. But is Farina saying that the reason you don't have a media specialist is because it's a school's decision not to have one? Is that what you see passing the buck here?
Yes, absolutely. Because that's not the first time I've heard that.
Okay, so let's talk about the, you mentioned the legal roundtable.
Yes.
Can you just fill us in? You're the chairperson for that?
Yes, I'm the chair, and it was created this academic year. Each time we meet in the beginning of our term, we always sit and decide what committees we feel that would be best serving the community. We have a parent leadership committee. We also have a education policy committee, and now we have the legal roundtable. I thought we needed the legal roundtable because in my prior term, we bumped heads as a council a lot with the DOE, and in reading their regulations and reading the state law, we would always get feedback saying that we interpreted the information incorrectly. There are about 9 of us on the Community Education Council with District 5, and we all read very well. And it was just, I couldn't fathom how every time there was a discussion, we interpret the law wrong. So out of that frustration came the legal roundtable.
You know, it's not just there, it's everywhere that people go about, well, you know what, you really haven't read this correctly. It's not, you know, you didn't read it correctly. Right. We have the correct interpretation.
Exactly.
And that's why, you know, I just want to give a little hello because Pierre is here.
Yes.
Said, who's on? Hello, Pierre. Okay. And he's part of the legal roundtable as well.
Yes,
and
it is a very important part of our legal roundtable.
Okay. So, how legally are you looking to get the city, the Department of Education, to get the librarians in? Is there a strategy, a legal strategy, or are we going to do some protesting?
Well, the letter was sort of the first step to just let the chancellor and Mayor de Blasio know that we heard you in August at your press conference, and we're following up. We're not letting this issue die.
Mm-hmm.
We want to level the playing field for our students, and it's just not fair, and you're not coming up with any viable solutions.
Right. So these initiatives that they say they were starting.
Yes.
Have you saw Farina mention, allude to on this thing?
Yes.
Has anything happened?
Nothing has happened. I know there has been some confusion about a initiative that was started prior to her August press conference, which is the 365 reading initiative. That had started already.
Okay, even before.
Even before.
Okay.
She came on? Her press conference.
Oh, before
yes.
Her press conference.
So it can't be that she's talking about this new reading initiative that she's going to launch in District 5.
So there's a lot of smoke and mirrors here.
There's a
just
lot
to show them, hey, we're doing something, but they're actually not doing anything. And if, you know what, and it's not us, it's the school itself, because, you know, they have their budget, they're supposed to do the media thing. Is that how this whole...
Is that, it's always passing the buck.
Passing the buck to somebody else?
It's always passing the buck. But what we do, what I can say proudly, is that what we do have in District 5, or some schools have identified that they can no longer continue like this. Mm-hmm. And we have one school in particular, Eagle Academy of Harlem, who have this year started. They've identified a room in their school. They've started the construction. They've started putting up bookcases. Mm-hmm. They've started cleaning it up and getting their computers and everything set up. So they are looking to launch the opening of their library in June, which is, yes, I'm so excited.
Is that a charter school?
It's a public school. And I'm so excited. But they, too, need a media specialist now. They need the budget line to hire a media specialist. But I'm very proud of them because they've taken steps.
Is the final thing is to get legal action on this? Is that what ultimately is going to happen if they...
Yes. But leading up to that, May 5th, what we're looking to do is have a rally in front of the Harlem State Office Building surrounding this issue regarding the libraries, because what I'm finding, which is heartbreaking, is that a lot of parents don't know that this is happening and the students don't understand that this is their right.
So who's organizing this?
I am.
You are?
Yes.
Well, there you go.
In collaborations with Community Board 10.
Well, you know, you have to keep me informed so I could always announce when this time. So May 5th, there's going to be a rally.
Saturday, May 5th, in front of the Harlem State Office Building. We're still working out the logistics, but definitely I will get you all the information.
Okay. And
you're invited.
Oh, boy, I'm there.
Come hang out with
us. I know Pierre be dragging me there.
Yeah, come hang out with us.
I want to say is that if people want to get in contact with you,
yes,
they just go to cecd5.org.
It's cecd5.org.
Mm-hmm. They already gave out wrong information.
That's okay.
Okay, and basically from here, they can contact you on whatever initiatives. And you also have, do you have a monthly meeting or quarterly meeting for the council? Or
We have monthly meetings. So our next meeting is Wednesday the 28th.
Okay.
And if you go to our website, you can find the location, because what we do is we try to move amongst our schools. So different schools house us for our meetings, which bring out more parent engagement.
Yeah, exactly. You need to go around.
We need you, parents.
It's a monthly meeting. All right. And even though if you're not a parent of a Harlem school person, you can come in. Anybody's welcome.
Yes.
To see what's going on.
Yes.
And
we need your energy. We need your creativity. We have, like I said, we have other committees that you could join, or you can attend our monthly meetings just to get an update on what's happening and give us feedback or maybe different avenues that we need to be taking.
Because I think that coming up soon, maybe not at your next meeting, but I'm sure you're going to hear something from the Department of Education concerning security over the recent shootings and things. I know we can't talk about it now because we really haven't got any information on that yet,
what
each individual school is going to do. But, you know, that might be something that's going to be discussed at the next meeting. But, you know,
yes, I'm pretty positive that on at our meeting on the 28th that the superintendent for our district will be making a statement about the school safety.
Yeah, because I did read the other day that there was an increase in lockdowns in the city.
Yeah,
but you know what? Don't hold me to, because you know what? I could read wrong.
Exactly, it's your interpretation now.
That's all. You know, Diane, and I think you need to come back, not just to give us an update on this, but you touched upon a very specific area, I think a battleground area, even a bigger one, mm-hmm. charter schools versus public schools.
Yes.
And just your opinion is charter schools, I know it's good to give some kids an opportunity mm-hmm. outside of the public school to, you know, to, but is it really hurting public schools, charter schools?
Yes, they're really sucking the life out of the public schools, and that is financially. Their charter schools get money from hedge funds, and most of them get money from public. They get public dollars. Our public schools only get public dollars.
Okay.
So there's an equity right there.
So you know what I think we do is, because we are getting close to wrapping up, mm-hmm. I think let's schedule a show after May 5th.
Okay.
After you rally, come back. Let's see how things are going.
Excellent.
And then maybe touch upon charter schools as well. And why is this? Because, you know, there's a big fight with the UFT and everything else.
Yes.
And there was a whole blow up. But you know what? We're focused on, hey, we know we got other problems. So why can't we get the media specialists in these schools with a $25 billion budget?
I don't understand why this has become so complicated. But if anyone wants to talk about the charter schools and the public schools, and we don't like to say that they're battling each other, because it shouldn't be that, but the powers that be have made it that. It's an either-or situation where it shouldn't be.
Yeah.
If people want to come to our meetings, because we are having discussions around those mm-hmm. topics and issues, it's not just this, and we're really trying very hard to level the playing field for everyone.
Well, you know, it's the whole thing. Everywhere you see people in power, per se, want people divided.
Yes.
Because once people start working together,
that's the problem.
Then come up better solutions.
Yes.
But it's all about money and how to keep money in certain people's pockets,
exactly.
I think. And Diane, I know that with people like you and